Oh, I'll share the screen first. Okay. Yes. So yesterday, before, actually, I forgot to say something. Maybe you noticed, but I didn't make it clear before. Before starting with the trigonal construction, I talked about some construction about how do you get from a Jacobian of a very generic 5-genus curve, and how can you get a double covering, and the double covering would be over a plane quintic, yes. So using the singularities of the theta divisors. So this result, so this construction actually, so just to make it clear, so from yesterday, for some reason I skipped that part. From yesterday, so what we have? We have a very generic Jacobian in the Jacobian locus of J5. And then we do this construction of taking the singular locus of the theta divisor Jacobian, which is a genus. Well, I mean, I'm not sure you want to recall everything, but that was something like this, take the singularities and the singularities modulo. Well, depends on where do you see the theta divisor, but this, there is you have always the minus one mapping in any abelian variety. And this is non-hyperelliptic, non-trigonal, and no vanishing tetanos. So in this context, you have this is a smooth genus 11 curve, and this is a plane quintic. This is what you describe as this will be the discriminant locus quintic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe I'm confusing two things. That's right. Okay. So you get a prim. So you get this, you call it C tilde C, and then you get the prim of C, C tilde C is again the Jacobian. Okay. So that is well in our construction due to even Montfort. Mm-hmm. That's right. I was looking at other things. That's right. Yes. Did I get it like this? I think so. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the corollary of the Montfort approximation yesterday is that actually the premap restricted to these quintics, mm-hmm, the premap P6 restricted from to the RQ. Remember, these are the double covering of quintics with the even to torsion point is bijective. So it's one-to-one correspondence between this Jacobian say, and those coverings playing quintics. But a little warning here is that the thing is not yet, this is just a bijection. And once you have to prove, and I'm not gonna do it, once it has to prove, that is not ramified there. Yeah, it's not ramified. It's not ramified. P6 is not ramified on RQ, and that involves again looking at the codifferential map if. This is some work to do, right? To prove that it's non-ramified. So it's not only that it's an abjection, say, okay, but maybe on that part will be completely, the map is ramified and in fact is we are not having a good count on the degree. So once you prove that, then the contribution of this locus is one. Okay? Okay, that's what I forgot to say yesterday. So let's come back to our other locus, the trigonal ones. Okay, done. For the trigonal ones, we had this trigonal construction, and we had talked a little bit about the generations. So what happens? Yeah, we can leave it to work out the different generations. But actually, so the trigonal construction. Construction from yesterday again gives you defines a map, allows to define a map then called tau from, and then give some notation from, this is always Donaghi's Smith notations, G14. So that means that you have a curve of genus G minus one with one G14. So let me put like this, one G14. So a tetragonal curve. And you can go to RG compactify. And then you have, of course, the prima, but this is, yeah, you have PG extended to HG minus one. Okay. So you get an allowable double coil. Okay, so that's right. I didn't talk, maybe I want to leave it for the exercises. We spoke yesterday about what happened when the G14 has two points, our fiber with the two double points or all the points together. And when you consider those cases, you get things on the boundary. But in any case, that would be something, well, there is one case which is singular, but we were not considered. But in any case, the others will be allowable. So the claim now, what I want to show is that you compose these two maps, this is tau, is the identity. Mm-hmm. So you get back this the identity. Let me see. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's a proposition. Let's define tau x like above. So first, PG from tau x is again the Jacobian of x. Ah, it's not properly the identity. Forget my claim. Is what I want to show. And second of all, the map, you have a map, I'm going to call it C, from C tilde into the Jacobian, that defined by, so what, remember what was C tilde in the trigonal, that was given by the trigonal construction, is they were the pairs above the pairs inside one divisor. So you have a pair AB that's sended to phi. Okay, I have to say what is what. I'm going to use this notation phi A plus phi B. Mm-hmm. So remember, this is the prim of this double covering is the Abel premap. Mm-hmm. So once you identify the Jacobian with the prim, you have what is the Abel premap? So let me put in a different color. The Abel premap is very similar like an Abel-Jacobi map. So you take is a composition of C tilde. You take the Abel-Jacobi map into the Jacobian of C tilde, and then you project into the prim with one minus the involution. Okay, this is the Abel Primat. Mm-hmm. And the, okay, actually I wanted a small one. And the fee, let me put, because I have notations for the canonical ones. So let's call it small fee. Mm-hmm. Small fee, okay. The small fee is actually the canonical, the Abel-Jacobi map for the core physics. Okay, so let's see. So everything makes sense. So you have let's see if it makes sense. So remember the that makes sense because if you remember the construction, the C tilde is a subset of the symmetric product of X tilde. So this A B are points in X. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, this is not so. So how do you go with the proof? So this is a typical proof. How do you prove that something is a prim, is a Jacobian, or more generally a prim? You need to use the universal. We use the universal property of the prims. Property of prim varieties. There is an universal property of Jacobian, so it's going to be very similar. Mm-hmm. So that means you have, every time you have a map from C tilde into Psi, into an abelian variety, that is more general, that is symmetric. Symmetric with respect to the involution in the, so C tilde comes with an involution. So you are, it's the double covering. You have a map, well, you have the Abel prim map that I define over. So it's the composition with, let's see, Abel Jacobi map into the Jacobian when you fix a point C tilde, and then you go to the prim by, so this is our Psi, yeah, that I defined here. But it depends from both fixed spot. And this is one minus iota. I don't know why I changed sigma. Well, I changed sigma because I call it here sigma. I don't know. Let's call it sigma. Yeah. Iota. The involution. Okay. Then, so every time you have a morphism from C that is symmetric, so you can put a curve inside the Jacobian, you can extend this map to the define this map to the, oops, into the, from the prim. Tilde into the Jacobian, and you close the diagram by a translation. You translate a translation by the minus the point that you use, the point, the base point. So C tilde. Okay, this C tilde that I use for the core. That's the universal property of the varieties. So I have such a symmetric map. Mm-hmm. So symmetric means that C and the involution commute, yes, minus C, okay? Mm-hmm. And this is what, and in our case, this is, so this phi has this property just by definition. Observe that mm-hmm, when you say C iota from A plus B, so what is iota of A plus B? The involution iota, so you see, mm-hmm, let's remember here, you have this X comes with this tetragonal, right? And over a point, you have A, B, C, D, okay? And the trigonal construction give you the diagonals, all the possible diagonals. CD, okay. This is the fiber over tilde over P. So if the involution of AB is to take the other two points, the complementary ones on the of the G14, C plus T, I'm C phone plus D. So my definition is phi from C plus phi from D. And this is minus phi A minus phi B. Because the sum of all these four is constant, yes? And the Jacobian of Sitilla. So you take phi A plus phi B plus phi C plus phi D. This could be zero. Well, yeah, you can see, you can translate it to be C. Marginalized constant is zero actually on the Jacobian of Sitilla, because all the four points lies over, that lies on a fiber, and this fiber depends only on P1, and P1 in the Jacobian maps to zero. This is constant. Yeah. So this is zero. So at the level of the Jacobian, the sum of these two points is minus the sum of the other two points. Okay, so it has this property of being symmetric. So the universal property of the spring varieties tell us that the C-tilde is well-defined. Okay, now it suffices to show, and that is, so I want to show that, what I want to show. Yes. Right, this is isomorphic. So it suffices to show that the homology class of the image of the curve in, so this is as homology class into the Jacobian of X, Z. Moment psi. Yes, is twice the minimal class. Twice the theta g minus 2, where theta is the class, so it's the class of the theta divisor in the Jacobian. So it's the class of the principal polarization. Okay. So that is this is Masiewicz's criterion. Maybe I want to recall it a little bit later. Masiewicz's criterion. And this is a little generalization of Matsuzaka criterion when saying something is a Jacobian. Well, and in this case, what I want to prove that is that the Jacobian is the prime variety, it's equivalent. Okay, so we are going to use the following degeneration. Okay, use a degeneration. This is, so one can compute the class by hand and show that it has the right class, but one way of, an easy way to look at this is by degeneration. So we are going to degenerate X, or put X in a family of such generic curves, and we are going to degenerate to the union of a curve of genus. One less, what we have put the names. Yeah, G minus one. So the difference is that this has, okay. This is a family of tetragonal curves. So you have a family of tetragonal curves, XT. Each one comes with a divisor, DT, G14, or a linear system. And at this, in the center of fiber is X null, glue with the P1, such that the points, three of them are here in X null, and the other is the gluing point. Yeah. Okay. So this is something you have to assume. Let me write it. Okay. So we have to assume that the limit divisor. Divisor class of this dt is d0 plus, no, let's call it d0 is the class of a g13 plus the point, the gluing point b0. For some p0 in x0. So in such a way that, so every ft is a 4-to-1, but the x, so when you restricted f0 restricted to x0 is a trigonal one. Okay, and then the other sheet is the p1. Okay, so I apply the trigonal construction to this degeneration. So to the central fiber, so the trigonal construction gives you that C tilde is going to be precisely our Vertinghen covariance. So you take x0, copies of x0, two copies, and then you glue, like we did yesterday. So like this. So that goes to x0, modulo p1, p2. Okay, and this one is 2-to-1. This comes with a trigonal covering, And the normalization of C is x0. So normalization of C is x0. Okay, so we are in business now. That's right. So what is the class of so first you notice that the class of what we are going to compute, the class of C does not change in the degeneration. So you did the trigonal construction for every element in the family. And this is, and what I'm showing here is just the central fiber. For the others, you have always this CT, see? You can do it for every T. Does not change in the degeneration family. Because essentially, yeah, this is a discrete element here. This is a discrete group. So they all have the same class. And in the limit, C of C tilde, how does it look? Well, is the union of phi x of the copies of these guys. So this is why it's very simple proof you do by generation, because you see immediately that you have two copies of x, of the embedding of x zeros. So let's put there. So is x zero prime and x zero b prime. That's precisely C tilde. And so this class is the same as this class, and this is twice the class of phi x under the Jacobi embedding. And then you know that, okay, at the the class of the curve inside of the Jacobian, this is again well known facts of Matsuzaka, for instance, this is twice the minimal class. So x, have to clear e, genus of x is g minus one. So this is one less. You can look at Matsutaka's criterion. Okay, and that's the proof. So this is not really, so this degeneration is not an expensive argument. if you have to apply these criteriums that we know for Jacobian. So the prim is twice what happens in the Jacobian. Okay. Yeah. So we have now let RT the RTG. So the double coverings, allowable double coverings. Well, no, let's say smooth ones, first of all, in RG, such that C is trigonal. And then consider the closure inside of RG. Okay. So we have this map tau that goes from pairs of curves with a G14 into RG. Okay. Now, the inverse construction, so we have also a way of going from here to here. By the inverse construction of the trigonal, we can conclude that the image of tau is the full RT. Yeah, because so every double cover, allowable double covering of a quintic, no, sorry, of a trigonal curve, it is the Jacobian Mason trigonal. Okay. So as a corollary for so here's the observation. This is general, but the main observation is when you have a genus 5 curve, it's always tetragonal. Remark, x in M5 is always tetragonal. And in fact, the general one will have the generic, and we will use this fact later, the generic x has exactly 5 E14s. That is by Prinleiter theory. Okay.
Angela.
Yes.
Say at most tetragonal, because hyperelliptic is not tetragonal in.
Oh, okay. They will have always tetragonal map. Maybe not. Yes. Depends how you call tetragonal. Has always a G14. Okay. Yes. Always has. G14. As you said, it could be older, that they are not formally tetragonal. That's right. So that is why you see this. Yeah, this construction in general, but if in lower genus, lower genus you have more G1 maps, but in higher genus, not every, there will be a smaller locus of those one having a G1 force. Okay, now let's compute the degree. Okay, so let's concentrate again in G16, in the case G equals 6. If I write it here, it's gonna be, I'm sorry. Yes, because it's the end of the page. So I have to write a little bit lower. So let's look at the diagram again. We blow up our, okay, let's blow up this RT, the closure of double covers of trigonals. Here, this is codimension 2. So remember, R6 has dimension 15, so this is dimension 13, but we computed yesterday properly. So yeah. And then this is the blob over RT of R6. R. And inside here you have the exceptional divisor that maps to RT. This is a P1 bundle. Mm-hmm. Okay, that is one side. And the other side, this RT maps over the Jacobian locus, A5. You have J5. This one is of dimension 3. Mm-hmm. We have much less. So actually, you have a one-dimensional fiber here. You blow up on this locus. Let's call it A5. Mm-hmm. Oops, A5. And inside the exceptional divisor. So here, the exceptional divisor is now a P2 one bundle. Mm-hmm. And you have the final. So in principle, it's only rational. This P6 tilde, and we are interested in computing the degree at the level of exceptional divisors. So now these two exceptional divisors, of course, as divisors, they have the same dimension, and this degree is well defined. Of course, one has to check first that the map is injective in every point. That was the condition yesterday. So let's see, should I check that? Let's see, I don't know if it's included in my I don't think so, but so recall that the codifferential, well, this is, let me write it here. Recall that we compute the codifferential of the pre-map is at the point, a particular point, is the symmetric product of A0 of the C omega C eta. So it's a multiplication of sections into A0 C omega C square. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, and we are doing for these particular points. So in this case, the kernel of the codifferential, you see, it has a kernel because now this is codimension 3. Let me see. Mm-hmm. It has a kernel. It's the quadrics. The kernel gonna be all the quadrics in P4 that contains the canonical, the prime canonical curve containing C. Mm-hmm. So I hope this, I mean, don't miss up with other C. This C, I'm gonna use this growth, the big C is the canonical prim canonical from C into the projectivization of C omega C tensor eta dual. So in general, it will always have one dimension less than the canonical, so it's PG minus one. This is called prime canonical. Okay, I think I defined it. And I will call the other big P, it's gonna go from X. And since it's generic, actually it's gonna be an embedding. This is actually an embedding top. Okay. That goes to omega X dual, but it's also PG minus one, five in my case. Mm-hmm. And sorry, what I'm saying, this is PG minus one. X is of five, is four. Alice, everything is four. Four and four. Mm-hmm. This is the canonical element. Okay. Now, yes. So I'm gonna give a very similar construction as the other plane quintics. So X is very general. So a non-hyperelliptic, just recall, X is X in M5, non-hyperelliptic, non-trigonal, and no trigonal, and no vanishing theta. Theta null. So vanishing theta null is when you have a theta characteristic with positive kappa, theta characteristic with sections, but the theta characteristic is even theta characteristic. So the square is the canonical. Oh, this is kappa. Sorry. It's gonna look like K, but it's kappa. This is X. Okay, this is a vanishing theta, but we don't have those ones. So since we don't have this vanishing theta, we don't have singularities on the singularity on the singular. So all the singularities of the theta X. So now I can write what I was doing right now. You can consider this. This is what I was saying. It's a smooth curve of genus 11 that can be computed. It comes with the involution induced by the questions. Oh, this is not for me. And I'm gonna call, this is just to stick to the Donagis, I'm gonna call alpha X. So alpha X, I wanted to think of alpha X as all the, it's a curve that parameterize all the G1 force in on the curve. Or more precisely, peak force on X, yes, with they have sections, H0 of L. So it's a singularity, has to be at least two. Actually, it will be two. Now, let's see, at least two. So, and then you have the quotient. It's called quotient F to distinguish from the other. Plus minus, yeah. That this you have a map. Okay. That's right. This is an Etal map. 2 to 1 is unramified, and this is a genus 6 curve. And actually, it's a plane quintic. Okay. So alpha X parameterizes all the G1-4. And every G1-4 on the X, it comes from a family of planes. Of planes on a singular quartic that contains the canonical curve. Okay. So it's how we construct the other plane quintics. But now I'm looking at the yes. Family of two planes. So you go through these two planes. So how does it look? You have a family, you have a singular quartic, but it's a singular quartic. You see, this is in P4. So this singular quartic is three-dimensional. It's a cone. It's a cone over a smooth two-dimensional quartic. short quadratic. Yeah, sorry, I'm missing out. Quadric, sorry. Yeah. So I am hesitated to make a drawing because it's not gonna be quite accurate, but but this quadric contains actually two families. So actually you have yeah, this comes from the involution, right? So you have this and you have k minus g1 4. This is the involution. And so you have to actually took this quadric, singular quadric S contains actually two families of planes, and each family of planes cutting out a G14 onyx. Yeah, so they always come by pairs, the G14s. So as a conclusion, okay, this you can identify this alpha X as the fiber of RT6 in T5 has one dimensional fiber. That's somehow we know over a generic gamex. Because the generic X, the generic X, or the generic Jacobian, has one dimensional family of singular quadrics containing one dimensional family of singular quadrics. Containing the canonical embedding. Okay. And this is, you can identify that with, so now you can identify the quadrics. You see, I am proving this proposition. The quadrics containing before is precisely parameterized also the fiber over a fixed generic GX. Okay. Now the computation. Now understand better the geometry, the local degree of P6 at RT is 10. So let me see, I wrote something. Yes, I think it's gonna be more or less clear that, okay. Remember, I don't know if you remember this, my notation that we have to show that. So we have that this map that I set. So that is the restriction of the P tilde to the fiber. It's injective on the normal space. I'd said, if only if it's surjective in conormal. Conormal spaces. So let me put it in context. What is this? So the projectivization of this guy is precisely P on the exceptionals over the point on the fiber over Z. Yes, so it's this map here, from here to here. So let's call it P on the exceptional, P tilde on the exceptional, yeah? So it goes from P1 bundle to P2 bundle. Okay, yeah. But the spaces are same dimension. Okay, same dimension. So it's subjugated on conormal, and the conormal on the conormal looks like this. It's the codifferential basic stern in conormal. Goes from, I don't know if I'm consistent with my notation, but this is conormal into the normal bundle RT R6 if this is surjective. So at one point, you see, you do it in over one fiber, this is of rank 3. Well, it's a bundle, it's a rank 2. But this is at most, we already computed the, so we already computed, we computed that the kernel of the full thing, and the kernel is one dimensional, it's at most one dimensional. So it's gonna be surjective. And this is surjective. So you see, this is just a part from the full cotangent space. Yeah. So this is just you have the full cotangent space M5 or G5, sorry. G5 and the the normal. And here is and this is the cotangent at the full A5. So you have the tangent to RT. Yeah, this normal here, this conormal. Oh, my is well. Maybe it's better to put the star here. Okay. And this is the cotangent to R6. Okay, and here this is the differential. The P6 here, and he has at most one. So this is surjective because, so this here, this is surjective. I am over time. Because the dimension of the kernel is at most one. So we here is one. So if you restrict it to one summand of the bundle, the kernel cannot grow. Can just the dimension of the kernel is at most one. The kernel restricted to conormal is at most one. So if it is rank 3 and rank 2 and the kernel is at most one, it has to be surjective. Okay, so we can really, and at least in this case, explicitly check the condition that our condition that tells you that the degree, we are computing the local degree property. So we make a break and just, and then I finish the computation to give you the 10. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, come back.